Can I formally start this meeting? I welcome Justice Committee's 23rd meeting of 2014. Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices which will interfere with broadcasting even when switched to silent? No apologies have been received. Turn to item one in the agenda. I invite the committee to agree to consider item three, the committee's work programme in private. Are you agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. Item two is an evidence session on police and fire reform with HM Inspector of Constabulary in Scotland and HM Chief Inspector of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. And the purpose of the session is to discuss inspection and thematic work in relation to the first year of the single services and to explore common themes arising from work of both inspectorates. I welcome to meeting Stephen Torrie, HM Chief Inspector of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, and Derek Penman, HM Inspector of Constabulary in Scotland, and Andy Cowie, Assistant Inspector of Constabulary in Scotland. And can I thank the witnesses for their written submissions. And what I want to say is we've had additional written submissions from the FBU and from the petitioner, Jodie Curtis. And I want to put this on the record that while I appreciate there may be very good reasons why we have late submissions, they're not very useful to the committee, nor indeed to other witnesses that may come before us, because members simply don't have the opportunity when they come in our inboxes at 5 o'clock at night on a Monday and they're sitting at 10 on a Tuesday, or even this morning. Thank you very much, committee, some this morning. It's almost really impossible for committee members to give them due consideration, though I know they will try. So I put this out to anyone else who wants to put in submissions. Try to get them in as early as possible, and that would be to assist you with the submissions being considered. Now, I understand that Mr. Torrie and Mr. Penn wish to make some opening remarks. Brief opening remarks, thank you, because you have given written submissions and I know members want to ask you questions. Now, who wants to kick off first? Mr. Penman, thank you.
If I can, thank you, Convener. Really just to thank you for the opportunity for us to come along today and give members some explanation of our inspection work and where we fit into both police and fire service. As you said, we've submitted a paper which kind of outlines some of our kind of thinking around that and some of the joint themes that we've come to. And really all that we had intended to say was really just a conclusion on there, which is that our shared view is in terms of the single police and fire service, we have a view that it has been effective to date. We both believe that fire and police are operationally stronger than their legacy services. What we have said in our paper, though, is that this is a reform journey. It only has started. And there needs to be an ongoing focus in both services around sustainability, localism and scrutiny to ensure that the medium and long-term success of both are fully realised. We didn't intend to go through the paper in any great detail. We felt that members would prefer to perhaps ask us some questions on that.
You've anticipated correctly. Mr. Torrie.
And thanks, Chair. Just to add my thanks to Mr. Penman's. In both inspectorates, one of the things we're very keen on is trying to add value to the work of the organisations, and we think being able to talk to the committee in this way actually helps us to do that. So we're very grateful for the opportunity.
You know, what would be useful is for the public record to explain how you work together so frequently for the public, for instance, RTAs. Could you perhaps explain how you have to communicate with each other, the different services? You're not in silos.
No, absolutely not. I mean, there's a long history of organisations working effectively together at every level. So from chief officers, chief constable, down to local area managers, down to individual firefighters and police officers on the beat. So there's a long-standing, close relationship. And therefore, we reflect that, we think, in the relationship between the two inspectorates.
Thank you. Committee members... Elaine, I wish I could read your name.
Yes, thanks
very
much.
My glasses on, it'll help. No, it doesn't. Right, Elaine.
I wanted really to sort of explore the issue of localism with you, and in particular the sort of relationships with local authorities, community planning partners and so on across Scotland. I mean, I, as you may or may not know, represent Dumfriesshire, and there certainly has been a feeling locally that there has been a lack of consultation between the services and the local council and other community planning partners, to the extent that actually the police and fire plans were rejected by the council. Do you feel, first of all, have you monitored this? Have you looked at the way in which people, the services are communicating?
Penman, yes. Your microphone will come on automatically.
That's great. Thank you. I think our starting point would be that localism will be absolutely key to the success of Police Scotland and I'm sure the Fire Service as well. My view certainly is that the legislation in particular allows for effective localism, it allows for the creation of local scrutiny plans, it gives responsibility to the local commander around there. So certainly from my perspective, I think the legislation allows for it to happen, and I think what's needing done now is there's more can be done around effectively that engagement, local policing plans that reflect the local community needs. As part of our inspection process, we are looking in particular at each division. We will go round each division in turn and we'll have a great interest in how effective that local engagement will be.
Mr. Torrie, sorry.
It's absolutely accepted that the Fire and Rescue Service might be run at a national level, but it is a local service, fundamentally a local service. And so that engagement locally is fundamentally important, and I think the organisation recognises that. The inspectorate has a real and genuine interest in this, but it's still early days for us. I mean, when we started to look at the beginning, this was at the beginning of reform, it was too early to make detailed comment. We published a report in May this year, which we reflected for the first time how we saw local partnership working. Those were in distinct areas, and we interviewed a few local partners. The picture we were getting actually was overwhelmingly positive at the time. So the people we interviewed in South Lanarkshire and Fife and so on, thought that they had always had a long-standing good relationship with Fire and Rescue Service, but either that hadn't changed or it had actually improved during the 18 months of reform. That's our early picture.
Possibly in my locality, it's also the lack of consultation over things like the closures of the control rooms and so on, which has contributed to. I'm not trying to criticise the local commanders either, and either service actually, who have a lot of respect for it. It's actually the way things have been done, and then laterally with the issue about armed police as well, where there didn't seem to be any consultation with local people at all, and maybe weren't even aware that certain changes were taking place.
We've noted those comments, but it's too early for us and we haven't looked at detail on how those engagements are working.
Mr. Penman wants to come in.
Just picking up on that point, one of the things that we are keen to do is what is the role for the commander, what can the commander influence locally and how do they work with the local scrutiny group? But there's also that important part that you've mentioned there, which is very much about how does a national decision have an impact on a local area, and in particular how is that decision communicated through meaningfully that the local communities feel that they're involved in that. We took the opportunity in our road policing thematic to make a recommendation to the Scottish Police Authority, which is effectively to do work with each of the local scrutiny committees to tease out exactly that point, which is, you know, what is their role in terms of local policing, but how do you communicate those national decisions?
Because you're inspectorate not just for the forces, but also in your case for the SPA, am I correct? Is that, do you also inspect them? And likewise, do you have the same inspection or overseeing of the Fire Service through the through their organisation as
we
well?
We do, but it's a slightly different arrangement, Chair. So the Fire and Rescue Service Board is not a separate corporate entity. So the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service does include the board and senior management.
So you don't scrutinise them in the same?
We do, but simply because they're part of that single organisational structure.
I just wanted to make it plain it was both. Yeah. Yes, sorry, Elaine.
I was just really a request, I suppose, that you would speak to people in places like Dumfries and Galloway as well, because of the levels of concern there have been. I mean, it's not just about looking at where people are content, it's actually if you can speak to the people locally who are discontent. I mean, I'm just dealing with a case at the moment where a constituent observed an armed police officer doing his shopping in Morrison's a couple of Saturdays ago. And there's issues like that create a lot of concern within local communities. And if we want Police Scotland and the Fire and Rescue Service to work well, we actually have to make sure that we're responding to those sort of local concerns.
Okay, got Margaret, followed by Alison, followed by Roderick, followed by John Finney.
Yeah, good morning, gentlemen. This question is really for Mr. Penman. The problems with ICT integration have been highlighted now, and a few weeks ago, Police Scotland was known to be 2 years away from having a fully unified ICT system with a cost of £60 million. It's running 9 months behind schedule. Just exactly what effect is this going to have on the efficiency of Police Scotland, also being hampered by 8 systems which, as you note in your report, Mr. Penman, do not talk to one another?
Certainly, ICT, I think, was always going to be one of those major challenges in bringing 8 services together into one. Prior to Police Scotland being established, they had the I6 project that you referred to, which is looking to create effectively the key systems in policing and having them rolled out. What there is just now is a number of workarounds across the country that allows things to continue. The divisional structure of policing currently is sort of coterminous with the previous legacy forces, so that minimises the impact just now on those legacy force systems. What we're keen to see in the inspectorate now is the ICT plan for the future, what that looks like, what the timescales are in relation to the rollouts for that, and also what the costs will be.
Give maybe a specific concern that's been raised just recently with the UK Statistics Authority report, which refused to endorse the recorded crime figures and then claims that police officers had massaged the figures and hadn't applied or complied with elements of the code of practice. Have you looked at that? Was that something you were aware of?
I'm aware of the UK Stats Authority report. My understanding is some of the media reporting had given the assertions that officers may have massaged figures. The UK Stats Authority report was more in relation to Scottish Government and assurances that they would seek around making sure that the crime figures are accurate. In terms of the inspectorate, we have had an interest in the ethical crime recording and the standards since 2004, and we have been doing a number of inspections since then. We took the opportunity at the start of Police Scotland in 2013 to do a review of crime recording, and we published a report with some recommendations around that. As part of our scrutiny plan this year, we've also committed to a significant crime recording review that will take us into far greater detail than we've done before, partly to address some of the issues from the UK Stats Authority, partly to address some of the claims and issues that have been done in the media, because I would like to be in a position where we can definitively say, in terms of our inspection, that the crime statistics in Scotland are valid or can be substantiated, and we do that through a fact-finding audit.
I mean, that's all sounded very good, but I'm none the wiser, I have to say. Could you give us specific as to, you know, this massaging? Obviously, these figures have been passed over from the police. On that basis, we're now looking allegedly at a 40% reduction in crime, when some of these figures about homicides, serious assaults, attempted, you know, are now in question. So where is the problem?
I think it's, for me, certainly it's understanding that the figures in Scotland, there have been since 2004 very specific requirements around crime recording and crime recording standards. There have also been checks and balances within each of the legacy forces around checking them. So if a crime is recorded on a daily basis, there are checks and balances to make sure that that has been properly recorded and it goes through a system of assurance. HMIC has previously been involved to make sure that these checks and balances are effective. What we're looking to do now is to extend our work in that area and give more statistical significance. In other words, we're going to check more records to give more confidence around the figures that we see. In terms of the 40%, I'm not aware of a 40% reduction in crime figures. I think there was a 40% reduction has been reported in stop search figures that's coming through. And again, that's another area that we are keen to look at, and we've made a commitment as part of our scrutiny review now to go and look at stop search and stop search recording in particular.
I think it's claimed that crime is at a 40% low. Could you give me a for example of something that's looked at that you're now checking more because it could have been recorded wrongly?
In terms of crime recording, what we actually do is we will send staff out around each of the divisions. They will sit down in front of the computer systems. They will listen to call records from someone who calls into a control room to report the crime. They will follow that all the way through, checking all the systems to see what did the person say on the phone, has the crime been properly recorded, does the incident record go into the crime record, is the crime properly established against the guidelines, and we'll follow it through in that level of detail. What we're looking to do is increase the sample size that we do and increase that across the country, because I'd like to be in a position to come back and give an assurance, one way or other, to be frank, around the efficacy of that crime recording and to ensure it's been done ethically.
And given this is an independent watchdog, the UK Statistics Authority, and they refer to a code of practice, have you talked to them? Have you had meetings with them? And what specifically in the code of conduct was causing problems and hasn't been complied with?
Again, my understanding from the UK Stats Authority report is some of the code of conduct is around the level of assurance that Scottish Government would give in relation to the statistics, and the HMIC review would be part of that as well. So there are codes of conduct that the Government would have in relation to official statistics, and we have a part to make sure that the police side is being recorded ethically and properly.
Can I ask you, you said your current sampling size, you're going to increase it. Can you give us your current sampling base and what you're increasing it to, please?
Yeah, if I could hand over to Andrew, who's going to be leading on that for us.
I wanted you to have something to say. I'm glad I asked.
Thank you very much, Chair. The last report that we did in last year is around 1,500 records were looked at. So that's incidents that were reported by the public, and we followed them all the way through as to whether there were no crimes, or recorded as no crimes or not. What we're now doing, and we'll be kicking this off in late August, going through to report in October, is looking at a sample size of around about 7,000 incidents, so approximately five times bigger. And the statisticians, I'm a police officer, not a statistician, but they tell me that will be statistically significant, not only at a national Scottish level, but also at the level of each division in Scotland, of which there are 14, as you're well aware, and also at the types of crime we're looking up. And picking up Ms. Mitchell's point there, we looked at sexual offences and violent crime the last time round. The performance was good, but we thought it could be better. So we're again looking at those categories of crime in this follow-up survey, which will look in much greater depth at that. So we bring the continuity of having looked at this from 2004 all the way through, just to refresh our actual terms of reference for that audit. And obviously a key part of that will be making sure that helps fit in with the recommendations from the UK Stats Authority about an independent and credible audit of crime statistics. Because we recognise the importance in October when we report to Parliament around that not only will the public make a judgment around official statistics, but Police Scotland need to have an accurate record if they're going to deploy the resources in the most appropriate way.
Thank you for that additional information. Alison, followed by Roderick, please.
Thank you very much. Mr. Penman, in your annual report last year, you looked at the things that would need to be addressed post-reform, and you highlighted in particular the need for a robust and professional system of governance, and that for that to be complemented by a clear definition of what the Chief Constable is solely operationally responsible for. It's certainly my contention that robust system of governance is not yet in place, and some of the issues around about stop and search and the routine arming of police officers seems to point to that, and it's fallen to MSPs to be the ones that are raising concerns. Do you feel that there's much more to be done yet in terms of the governance?
I think that's a very valid observation around there. In our paper, we refer to scrutiny. I think now we are almost 16 months into policing now is a good time, I think, to look at the scrutiny structures that exist and work out what are the individual roles, responsibilities and indeed boundaries that exist among all of that. I think it's helpful that we're 16 months into this rather than trying to design it from the start, and there's perhaps opportunities for everyone involved in that scrutiny to reflect on some of the difficult issues, some that may have been done well, others that may not have been done quite as well, and actually trying to work out how do we build the scrutiny arrangements for a democratic Scotland moving forward. I think that would be a helpful, timely opportunity to do that now.
If I might, Convener, round about operational independence. I mean, surely it's not sufficient for the Chief Constable just to assert that something is operational and, you know, his operational responsibility. It would be helpful perhaps to have a memorandum of understanding or some code that sets out some of the parameters. Would that be a useful way forward?
I think that the concept of operational independence is based on some case law and based on convention around that. I think there's certainly an opportunity to look at that and have a constructive dialogue around what that would mean. In any case, operational independence still requires operational accountability. and there is still the need for that accountability to take place. The legislation, as it is framed under the Police and Fire Reform Act, under Section 21E, is the responsibility for the police authority to hold the Chief Constable to account. So although there are definitely decisions that, in my mind, would be operational, which means free from political interference or can't be directed to do certain things, there is still a need for the Chief Constable to be accountable for those decisions, and the framework would exist through the police authority for that to happen. But I think now that we're 16 months in is a good time, I think, to start a constructive, forward-looking debate around the individual roles and responsibilities, including ourselves as scrutiny bodies, and where we all sit and feed in to add value.
That's important.
Thank you. Roderick.
Thank you, Convener. Just on a new topic, as Alison has raised one that I was going to raise, just in relation to police custody, any thoughts on Police Scotland's approach to single cell occupancy, or what investigations have you carried out to date on that?
Yep, thank you for that. As you'll be aware, we have carried out a thematic review. We've carried out a number of them, which were in areas where there's a particular need to bring a national dimension to what were eight legacy forces. So we took the opportunity to review custody early on. In that, we made a number of observations and a number of recommendations moving forward. One of them was around the single cell occupancy. The situation prior to Police Scotland, where the ACPOS guidance of the eight forces would be that single occupancy would be something that was desirable, and indeed you would make every effort to have single occupancy. On a number of legacy forces, when areas were peak demand, that was difficult to achieve, and they would move to multiple occupancy just to effectively manage that demand through custody. When Police Scotland have come through, there is the policy of single occupancy, which we absolutely support moving forward. But if that decision is taken where you don't have necessarily the infrastructure to support it at that time, then it makes it more difficult, I think. And the result of that, perhaps, is having to move prisoners around Scotland to accommodate that. So what we've said in practice is for Police Scotland to review their policy of single occupancy and look to see, in terms of a proper risk-based approach, whether they can have some flexibility.
OK. Has Police Scotland give you any indication as to when they'll complete that review?
We've only just published the custody review, so we would normally give them some weeks to consider our recommendations, and we will work with them now in taking them forward and then follow up on them as well.
Thank you.
John Finney.
Thank you, Convener. It's a question for Mr. Torrie. Mr. Torrie, it relates to the submission we have from you, and I'm grateful for that. And the third section headed up leadership and governance. And if I can quote to you from it, in November 2013, HMI, FRS made comment about the importance of effective working between the Fire Board and the strategic leadership team. This has not been explicitly followed up to date, but relationships continue to be of interest in the Inspectorate's risk assessment. Can you comment a bit further on that, and to be parochial, particularly in relation to, for instance, the tensions that did exist in the area I represent, the Highlands Islands, about the period, about the... that's my obligation, of course, to be there. The tensions that existed there about deficiencies that were identified at that time, and whether the move to single service has improved that situation at all, please.
So there's a direct...
There. It's just that John Finney mentions the Highlands and Islands every week, and we wait for the trigger for it to come in, but of course it's a serious question.
And I have seen that reaction in this committee before, so it wasn't a surprise. So there's pretty much a direct read across to that previous discussion we just had with police authority and the Chief Constable. So the way that the Fire and Rescue Service is set up is intended to provide that kind of healthy tension between the board, who are kind of non-executive people, you know, they don't know how to run a fire service professionally, and the relationship with the professionals and professional managers. So all we are saying in our report is, look, these things are fundamentally important. If you want a good, healthy organisation, then that's a good way to set it up, and we're interested in the effectiveness, how the two bodies work together. And it's exactly the same conversation about, you know, operational autonomy, operational independence versus scrutiny and challenge. So there are many things that the chief officer and his team will need to make judgments on, make decisions on. But of course, almost all or all of them are open to challenge and should be explainable to the fire board, whose job it is to hold the chief officer to account. So we are interested in that. The one thing I would say to you in terms of reflecting on your own experience is that in the past, we have had to deal with eight different sets of relationships, where now it's just the one set of relationships. So in a sense, life becomes a bit easier for us. But there's no doubt that these things are long-term. It's all about human relationship and building confidence in the different bodies. So that's why we're saying we will have an ongoing interest in how these things work out.
And specifically on the question of plugging what was seen as a gap in the resilience of the former service area, has that been addressed?
We have looked at that in great detail. And what we've said is, you know, Fallon, you'll remember the report that HMI published on Highlands and Isles specifically. And what we've said is, throughout our work, we'll continue to take an interest and focus on that. So we have made comment on the gaps that have been plugged, and we are saying we will continue to monitor to see whether that's been successful. I mean, most of the observations we've made to date and most of the things we've reported on say that that's continued to be successful. But where we do see ongoing issues or the potential for you know, a kind of fallback to something that something similar to that we saw before, we would take an interest in and we would report on.
And the challenges I understand that exist across Scotland, not exclusively relating to rural areas, about the resilience from different lifestyle patterns that see people working in central areas rather than towns, to staff, crews and vehicles. Is that something that's an ongoing feature of your work?
Yeah, and we've said in our submission, Chair, that we think the fragility of the whole retained duty system, volunteer system across Scotland is something that needs particular attention. It's something we know the fire service is focused on, and we want to work with the fire service in terms of resolving that or trying to address that the best they can.
Okay, thank you very much.
Would you develop the word fragility there, please, of the retained firefighters?
It's kind of management speak, is it?
Yes. I don't mean that unkindly, just no. To put it into, you know, people speak. So what do you mean? That people, they're not being retained, they're giving up?
Yeah.
Is there a morale? What do you mean?
Just in plain language, to paint a picture, a typical village in Scotland where about 85% of Scotland's fire stations rely wholly or partly on retained or volunteer staff. So a typical village might have 15, 16, 17 people who are trained to be firefighters, who carry a pager around. But of course, they all have day jobs and they all have different things to do. So typically nowadays, people in a village won't work in the village, they'll work somewhere else. And so during the day, there are many areas of Scotland where it's a huge amount of pressure to have a crew available, and it's very, very difficult to manage those things. And that then knocks on to retention. So, you know, if you're someone who's committed to give 120 hours a week of availability, but you've also got a job to do somewhere else in Scotland to travel back, then these are big, big challenges. So the kind of lifestyles of people in Scotland's towns and villages has changed, and that's having a fairly significant effect on how well you can manage volunteer and retained units.
And that really is separate, or is mainly separate from the issue of a single service.
It's
that would have happened anyway.
It's entirely separate.
Yeah.
And it's been evolving over a long time.
Yep. Sandra, followed by Christian, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. Thank you very much for your submission and the conclusion. Basically, I want to pick up on some of the stuff for the conclusion. But first, I would like a wee bit of clarification. I think it was in regards to Margaret's question about this UK independent crime reporting unit. I seem to remember that Willie Rennie and also Graham Pearson had said that it was disgraceful that the Scottish Government were saying that crime was falling, because it was falling all over, not just here but in England as well. So I just wonder, what authority does this so-called unit have to ask questions of, you know, basically the Scottish Government and the reporting, and I would say cast aspersions on the actual numbers that they're talking about?
I'm perhaps not best placed to answer that in its entirety, but it may be helpful to explain the roles. So my understanding is,
rather than being political, I think, yes.
My understanding is that the UK Stats Authority have responsibility for effectively how accurate the UK official statistics are, and there are certain code of practice that would have to be followed for something to be given the designation of an official statistic. And previously, the crime statistics have had that. That is totally separate from our role in relation to the crime audit. We have been involved in checking the official crime stats, as I said, since 2004. And what we are about to embark on now is a broader and more detailed study of that. That is in relation to us independently assessing that to provide a report, actually, that will come here ultimately to give members a view or information, and hopefully be able to judge for yourself whether the figures are accurate or otherwise. I think the UK stats part of that is that they would be interested in the extent to which Scottish Government would look at our independent assurance and how that would feature into their framework of assurance to say it can have the designation of an official statistic.
Thank you. Very helpful. And I just wondered if we could return that favour then and ask for their, you know, look at their crime stats. I'm just throwing that open. I don't know if we have the authority to do that.
We'll leave it open. Another question.
Perhaps I'll write to the Cabinet Secretary and ask, Cabinet Secretary. I think if one is allowed to do that, I think we should be allowed to do the same there as well and find out exactly where we are with it. But the question...
Where's your next question, Sandra, please?
The question I wanted to ask was in regard to, you know, sustainability and partnership working as well, particularly when there's events such as the huge events, Commonwealth Games that we had recently, and the unfortunate, you know, horrific accident like the Clutha Vaults and various others. How has it worked with the One Police Force? Has it been better being able to do that if you're reacting to either an emergency or a huge event? Is it how does it work?
Fire and Rescue Service will be involved. That's when I was getting it. You probably don't always recognise the teams are there together because of the nature of what's taking place. So yeah, maybe ask it both.
I was just going to say that. That's why I mentioned partnership working. So I just
I think in terms of our joint submission, I think we both recognise that, and I think the real strength of the single service has been that ability to pool resources nationally, work together nationally better. And I think, you know, sadly, some examples that they've had to deal with over that piece have been dealt with extremely professionally. The real strength and one of the benefits of police reform is the ability to move, if you like, those specialist assets across the country in terms of policing, whether they're investigators or, you know, major inquiry teams for large, you know, for murders or criminal inquiries. From that, and I know the same will be the case for fire service in terms of specialist resources, but perhaps pass to Steve.
So I think the Clutha Bar, actually, that you mentioned is a really good example of where things are now with the National Fire and Rescue Service. So naturally enough, the initial response to Clutha Bar came from local crews, but within a very short period of time, there were specialists from across Scotland and command team officers from across Scotland. Now, prior to reform, sometimes that would have happened, but it would have been unusual, where now it's normal. It's a very straightforward thing for the National Fire and Rescue Service to mobilise resources to any type of incident.
Just not another question, Kavina, just a comment that, you know, when you think about it, it's actually amazing when there has been incidents and before this single reform.
Sandra, I love you dearly, but we're here to ask questions.
I'm quite amazed that that would have been very difficult previous to this. That's all I'm going to say.
I think it was said by, I think we appreciate from your thing, and I think that is one of the recognised advantages where you need major incidents. You don't have, I think previously, in fact, we understood that a chief constable of a constabulary had to pay for a helicopter, say, to come from somewhere out of his budget. And there was this idea that, you know, the helicopter belonged to somebody else in another constabulary or whatever, and now it belongs to the whole force. Is that correct? That's putting it simply. I think I've got that wrong. I can tell by your face.
No, you haven't. I mean, effectively, each individual force had responsibility and each chief constable had responsibility for the incidents in that area. So where the incident became so large, you required to have, especially specialist assets, you would draw them in on mutual aid from other forces, and that included Scotland. The Legacy Strathclyde was the only force that had a helicopter, so that if you used that helicopter, there was always the potential to be cross-charged against that, although quite often they were provided and, you know, if they were required.
There was a possibility that constabulary had to cut the cost of that.
Yeah, absolutely. If you needed to have other officers in for a large-scale demonstration and you're required to have something like the Commonwealth Games, you would require mutual aid to come in from other forces and potentially recharge for that.
Thank you. I'm just reminding myself that Christian, followed by Margaret. I'll take Christian. I think you've been in already, Margaret, so I'll take John Pentland next after Christian, who's not been in yet, then Margaret. Christian.
Pleasure, Convener. Yeah, just an inquiry following the question on the written firefighters, and I think you give a very good answer, Mr. Torrie. I would like maybe ask a similar question on how challenging it is to recruit new police officers, particularly I represent the northeast, and we know how difficult it is in the Aberdeen area.
I don't have the figures to hand, and perhaps more of a question for Police Scotland, but in general terms, I think, you know, there's still not a huge difficulty in recruiting police officers. I think the issue is about how you would locate them across the country, and I know there are and have been some challenges in the North East in terms of having officers in that area, and also on some of the islands as well, in trying to attract candidates who could actually then go and relocate there. But I don't have the figures to hand around that.
On the same line of questioning when you had with the fire service, do you think having a single service is not a separate issue? Has it got any changes due to the changes of single service?
I mean, I think our assessment is that the single service is working very well, and operationally, I say it was stronger than the legacy forces has been our take on that. In terms of the recruitment question, there's opportunities to recruit nationally and to post people around the country nationally as well, so that there are probably greater opportunity to do that. If people want to join the police and they're prepared to move, you wouldn't have to recruit people into the various local 8 forces. You can recruit centrally and then move people around the country to where the demand is. But that has to be supported as well around people's ability to move and relocate and the cost of that as well.
Have you found some example of this already? Yeah.
I don't have anything to hand, but I know that Police Scotland are very exercised around how will they get officers into North East, and in particular how to get officers onto islands, and that is something I think they're looking to actively recruit. I think some of that might be to try and recruit individuals in a kind of more local area, so try and recruit people for the North East from the North East, I think is one of the areas that they're looking at.
If I can add another question.
Highlands and Islands, North East and Fleece and Galloway, I'm expecting to get... Well, Motherwell and Wishaw is going to be punting. This is supposed to be a committee, not constituency issues, but on you go.
If I can ask another different question about armed officers. I visited some of the armed officers in the North East and spoke to them. Some of them seem to be a bit frustrated about the news, thinking that it's old news, they've done that already, they were seen before being armed. And do you feel that the officers, have you got some assessment of armed officers saying the same thing, a little frustration about the news just now?
What we have done is we've undertaken, HMIC has undertaken to do a review in relation to armed policing, and we published our terms of reference only last week in relation to that. Some of that will be around the decision of the Chief Constable around the standing authority. We've extended our terms of reference around looking at things like how the firearms are carried and what the deployment criteria are. One of the things we will be doing is we will be speaking to officers who carry firearms to seek their views as part of that. That's part of our methodology that we've agreed to do from there. But I say it would be too early just now to... We haven't gathered evidence yet and we haven't yet reported on that.
I was
just going to say this is coming up for the subcommittee on Thursday as well, isn't it? So, yes.
If I may, maybe, what's the role of commanders, really? Have they got free hands? Maybe they have more free hands than they thought they had when the single force was created.
I suppose it all depends on the definition of the commander. I mean, what there is in Police Scotland is you have divisional commanders who are responsible for each of the 14 divisions. They have got statutory responsibility for the local policing in that area, and it's perhaps going back to some of the earlier questions around how effective are the local policing plans and that local engagement in that area. I think that's certainly there's been meaningful engagement. I think they're in their second year of doing local policing plans. I think there's probably more can be done for the third iteration of them to make sure that they fully reflect the community needs. I think part of the localism that we refer to will be that greater empowerment of commanders moving forward within their own areas.
Mr. Penman, I suppose one of the biggest challenges you've faced over the piece has been workforce planning. And recently we've seen quite a lot of civilian jobs being lost. And these have been taken up by police officers, police constables. Do you think perhaps that's been a wrong decision? And when are you likely to... What work have you done to sort of square that circle?
And obviously, in terms of workforce planning, I think it's one of the areas that we still feel is underdeveloped in Police Scotland. And we're looking for some more detail around that as we go into our scrutiny programme this year. clearly what we're looking for Police Scotland to design the new service in a way that is sustainable moving forward. And some of that, I think, also has to include what is the appropriate workforce balance moving forward from there. Certainly, my understanding is Police Scotland and the authority are not looking to have, police officers backfilling or routinely backfilling posts around there. It is one of the areas that we will look at as we go through part of our inspection programme to see the extent to which that may or may not exist.
So do you think perhaps at this time and moment that civilian jobs are should be, looked at more closely and we should not have, police officers filling the backroom jobs?
My professional view is moving forward there needs to be a balanced workforce. And that balanced workforce would be the appropriate mix of police officers and police staff to provide the optimum service to the communities. What that is, I'm not sure of. I think, and it's Police Scotland and the authority, police authority, I think, have to work their way through in terms of where they are now and where they need to be, and what will that look like in terms of a balanced workforce and what the workforce plan will be to get them there.
And again, Mr. Penman, with regards to the review that you're undertaking after 16 or 17 months, again, over the piece, we've seen quite a lot of police station closures and reduced hours. Will you be looking at that again to see if because obviously this was a great service that was provided to the public, and we may have got that wrong too somewhere down the line?
Our absolute focus when we do our inspections will be looking at the service delivery to local communities from there. To my knowledge, there have been no station closures or very few station closures. I think there's been a reduction in opening hours of some of the stations that were moving forward around there, as opposed to station physically closing. Police officers were still working from there, and that was the commitment, I think, that Police Scotland had given around there. As we embark upon our new inspection regime, we brought in what we call Local Policing Plus. That will take us around each of the 14 divisions, and part of that assessment will be the services that are being provided to local communities. So that would include, for example, what the footprint is of policing in that local community and how well some of these police officers are being used, to be frank, as well.
Thank you. I've got Margaret followed by Alison, please.
Mr. Penman, the thematic inspection for road policing, which was reported in July, expressed concerns about the impact of the absence again of a national ICT integration, this time on road policing, and particularly over the variability and level of local scrutiny and engagement in relation to road policing. Could you comment further on that?
We took the opportunity in our thematic inspection early on to look at roads policing. So in terms of the issue of ICT, again, it wasn't unforeseen. It's not of Police Scotland's making. It's inevitable as you move into forces without a single national ICT system that there would be some difficulties effectively in terms of ICT, especially for those officers who are moving across boundaries. As I said earlier, the majority of officers still work within their legacy boundaries, which means the ICT impact is minimalised. But when you start to have road policing officers who might move across a region, then there are some impacts on them not being able to access legacy systems. Police Scotland identified that early on in their defence, and they have put workarounds in place in relation to that, in terms of that, in terms of ICT.
If I can be more specific about the variability, for example, the DVLA figures released recently shows a disproportionate, it seems, trend where people in Scotland are more likely to have points on their licence than elsewhere in the UK. I also highlighted certain areas, the G69 postcode, including Bayliston, Garryhill, Glasgow, Moodysfarne, Kirkcaldy, North Lanarkshire, being targeted particularly. And in the report, then you mention that there's a lack of clarity about the priority given to road crime. Could you elaborate on that?
Yep, certainly. What we looked at in the report was the impact of performance and how enforcement activities are driven from there. As you'll see in the report, we identified there were some significant increases across the country in areas such as speeding or seatbelt offences and mobile phones. What we said in our report effectively was, although that in itself is fine because people are breaking the law, there is a bit to say to what extent does that actually have an impact on driver behaviour, and we start to deliver outcomes in relation to that. I suppose some of our questions questions that we've asked of Police Scotland is to look at their performance regime, look at that across the country, and the extent to which actually they are confident that by having officers targeting certain areas, that those areas will actually have a positive impact on outcomes, which would be reduced casualties and modifying driver behaviour.
Yeah, on outcomes specifically, I've mentioned one area. There were other areas mentioned. If an area is particularly a black spot and a target, then surely, you know, if it's not all about collecting cash and it's actually prevention and road safety, shouldn't that be looked at for average speed cameras, for example, rather than obviously looking? Is these things that you've looked at in terms of outcomes and also in terms of the leadership, the new road policing model is strengthening the connection between police services and communities. But at the same time, you highlight this perception about a 10% target, police being actually targeted for 10% increase in these crimes, when in actual fact, I think Police Scotland was established, it was up about 37%. Surely there's a real question about management and performance here and about the priorities that are being set when there's so many other serious offences that seem to be not getting just the same priority.
It's a fair question. I think that there are two points in your question. One of them, I think, is does the new road, or do the road, new road policing structure strengthen that local connection? Our view would be that they do, in as much as each of the 14 divisions now have their own dedicated road policing unit that works to the divisional commander, and then that then has the ability to deal with local priorities around that. So to that extent, we feel that that local connection is strengthened. And in terms of performance issues, for us, it's very much about making sure that within that performance regime that it actually is being targeted towards the right things and the right priorities within that community. So if Police Scotland are going to be targeting speeders, which is absolutely appropriate, then you want to target speeders in those areas which are the highest risk, around schools, around areas that community are concerned around, and where it will have the largest impact. And that was effectively the questions we're asking of Police Scotland, is to look at that and ensure themselves and put safeguards in place to make sure that if targets are being put forward and officers are working to priorities, that effectively they're doing them in the areas that will have the biggest impact.
Is it not almost the case that the higher these crimes are recorded, the more of them, it's almost an admission of failure? Surely they should be coming down if it's an effective remedy, and if it isn't, shouldn't other remedies be looked at?
I think it is again a very valid point around the extent to which enforcement will drive behaviours or change of behaviours in people. Effectively, if people are speeding, they are breaking the law in relation to that. There is no doubt that speeding is a major contributory factor to road casualties. So there is something about police officers enforcing speeding. I think there is a bigger part around how do you start to modify driver behaviour and how do you satisfy yourself. You have a range of tactics, if you like, that will start to have an impact on that.
On the outcomes and analysing that to get the best policy.
Our view is very much about if you're going to direct the activity and significant activity in policing, you would want to be satisfied that the outcomes that you're seeking to achieve will be met by that target.
Can I just say that I certainly have found that I must mention the Scottish borders, as it's not a dimension, but the police there have increased their activity with having unoccupied police cars sitting, which have a great impact on everybody driving up and down, because we all know where the speed cameras are, but we don't always know where they're unoccupied. And you just need to see a police thing on the side of a car, and everybody, you see the brakes going on all in front of you, and you wonder what's up. Not that I'm speeding, this is not a declaration, but can I say that I'm interested in the fact that you're looking at what different areas do, and you didn't mention rural areas where there is a separate issue about speeding from outside schools and so on. When you have, for instance, cyclists out the weekend or motorcyclists out on roads where they think they're on some kind of, racetrack. So it's interesting to see what's being followed up with rural areas rather than just outside schools and communities.
I think, as we mentioned in our report, convener, that Police Scotland have identified, they did analysis and identified where effectively were those hotspots around there, and they have looked, or they are still looking to shift resources up into the north and the northeast in particular, so they can actually deal with effectively the rural roads, because they do present a different issue from motorways and from other parts. And again, the casualty rate is higher in the north and the northeast and rural roads as well, and Police Scotland are mindful of that.
Thank you. Alison, followed by Elaine.
Distinct questions.
No, There we are. On you go.
Okay. With a question for Mr. Torrie. If you could elaborate a little on the strand that's within your business plan for the forthcoming year around emergency medical services and the SFRS. Just explain a little bit more what you intend to do with that.
So this is something that we're actively working on at the moment, and we expect to lay a report before Parliament in October. So it's fundamentally about how the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service works with Scottish Ambulance, but also more broadly how it deploys equipment it owns and the skills its staff have. So we've been very actively working, talking to the service, talking to Scottish Ambulance, talking to Scottish Government people, because there's that big relationship between health people in government and fire and rescue justice people. So we've got lots of interesting conversations going on. I mean, our kind of starting point is that although there's a good relationship, then in practical terms, it's not a deep relationship. You know, and I'll give you just one example of that. There are examples of what's called co-responder, where Scottish Ambulance might mobilise some firefighters at the same time they mobilise an ambulance. But there are only two stations out of the 359 in Scotland which currently run these services. So we've been up to talk to the staff and learn lessons from them. They are both in Aberdeenshire. They're at Maud and Braemar.
Okay.
So they were inherited from Grampian Fire and Rescue Service. So we're very interested in, you know, the benefits that can be gained by rolling that more broadly across Scotland. What we're not doing is to try and justify that there's a business case, because we think there is a very, very strong argument. There's loads of examples in England and Wales. There's loads of international examples where close working and collaboration between emergency ambulance and fire and rescue services brings great benefit. And finally, I'll just say, we hope it's going to be supportive, but we hope also that it'll tie in with something Scottish Government and ministers are looking at the moment, which is something they're calling a community resuscitation strategy. So again, we're having conversations with the ministers' officials to see how those things can mesh together.
That's very helpful, thank you. And could I ask Mr. Penman, in relation to the piece of work that you're going to carry out on stop and search, whether you would consider within that the kind of ethical issues that are raised by there being no power to search for alcohol, and yet the recording of confiscations of alcohol, and of course the use of a consensual search for something that you don't have a power to search for in the first place. So I think that's an issue that I would hope that you would be able to explore.
So certainly we're just finalising our terms of reference for the stop search. Our original approach was very much to look at the recording and some of the claims about under-recording or over-recording and actually get to the bottom of that from there. It's certainly one of the things that we could take on board. I have a view at the moment that many of these interactions with police officers in relation to alcohol have a legislative framework. A lot of them are done under the legislation that arises for alcohol seizures, and quite often I think police officers will approach that affects for young people because the offence is for under 18 and they'll ask for the alcohol to be handed across. And that is permitted by the legislation. The legislation also has safeguards about reasonable suspicion and also has some safeguards about asking for names and addresses. My understanding is they will currently then be recorded as a consensual search because effectively if they went on to search them, that goes beyond the power in the legislation. So I actually think there is some work that I would quite like to do is to understand what is the actual practice of police officers, because if police officers are effectively seeing young people with alcohol and they're going along and seizing that alcohol, they're doing that within a legislative framework. And if they're not searching the young people, they're merely seizing the alcohol, and that might sound like a distinction, but actually the legislation allows for that, and if that's been recorded as a consensual search, my own personal view is that I think that's slanting the figures significantly, and it gives the impression that there are a lot of consensual, non-legislative searches that actually are probably officers exercising their powers, and it's coming down to the recording practice about what is a search and what is a seizure. I think if police officers go beyond the seizure and take the alcohol and go in to basically have young people turning out their pockets, then that's a search, and I think that would be moving beyond the legislation. But I do think that it's a piece of work that's worth looking at to see the extent to which that interaction by officers has actually got some legislative basis on that, and that I think would bring down the number of genuine consensual searches into something that's perhaps a bit better to understand.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very helpful. And Elaine.
Yes.
two of the concerns which I think have been raised about Police Scotland, and I would address this to Mr. Penman, is first that Police Scotland is becoming increasingly target-driven, and secondly that the methods of operation of the former Strathclyde Constabulary are being rolled out right across Scotland. I wondered if you had heard these concerns, first of all, and if you thought there was any justification for them.
Clearly, in terms of our research and looking forward to see what are the things we would scrutinise, we would look across media reports, we'd also engage with staff associations, and we'd pick up any comments that were being made. In terms of the performance, we took an opportunity to look at that in terms of road policing, and have made some recommendations around that and about Police Scotland understanding the impact of a performance culture and how that drives operational behaviours, and in particular what outcomes are achieved. So that's road policing, but it goes beyond road policing into the targets more generally in relation to that.
As far as sort of there's a feeling, if you like, that Police Scotland is Strathclyde Constabulary at large.
Yeah, I mean, my first part is it's probably not Strathclydeisation. I think that around some of that, I think it's inevitable in a police service that the Chief Constable who's leading that will move the force in a direction that he believes is the right direction. So it's probably more about the Chief Constable's style than it is about Strathclyde from there. The other point for me, I think, is that when you have eight organisations that have to come into one, I think it's inevitable that what you have is a very short, sharp focus in relation to having everybody understanding what the priorities are, very much focused on service delivery around that. So I think it's inevitable in an initial part to get everybody looking in the same direction, understanding the new organisation to bring some of that through. As I picked up in my paper, and I think you picked up in your first question, localism is the key to all of this, I believe. The legislation is absolutely key, that you can have national and you have local, and the local policing plans and local engagement from commanders would be the way forward. So I would hope as policing starts to mature, and it is after all only, I think, 16 months into the new organisation, that it will start to move in, and that localism and that empowerment is something that would move forward.
Thanks. I want to just ask the final thing, because it's people who are in the services, and it's very hard for people who've had one way of doing things for many years to suddenly find, this turmoil, not just in the organisation perhaps and where they live and what their future is and so on. So in terms of morale of police and fire service, whether civilian or uniformed, and in terms of whistleblowing, to you, because if you're just talking to the bosses all the time, and I know you're not naive to just do that, just gives a little picture of how the ordinary police officer, fire officer, so manages to say something to you at the inspectorate that they can't perhaps say in public to us at a committee about how they feel, whether rightly or wrongly, or comments that they have to make.
Certainly, in terms of our own methodology, we look to involve police officers in all the scrutiny work that we do. So the example around armed policing, in our methodology, we'll have a commitment to speak to officers who are firearms officers, and also commanders and other people who are involved in policing. As part of our local policing methodology, we will run a series of focus. We have done, in fact, in Fife, we run a series of focus groups where we would encourage police officers to come and speak to us. We also...
Because you see, focus groups are not going to tell you stuff. We have chats with people when we go round, and I think we're aware sometimes that we're not always getting everything. So how does somebody reach beyond these formal things? They may be right, they may be wrong, but I think their voices have to be heard in your roles as inspectors. So how do they get past focus groups and formal things? Maybe just send you stuff and say, look here, look there. This is what I feel.
Yeah, no, I think it's a fair point. My experience, actually, the focus groups have been very forthcoming, and a lot of officers have taken the opportunity to come and raise issues with us. But the other part is we also try and link in through the staff associations in particular, so we're linking closely with the Federation and ASP. But I think there is a valid point around how the individual officers perhaps contact us anonymously or otherwise with any issues that they would have. Clearly, if that was done through existing channels, we would take that very seriously. But I think you raise a fair point for us around how we might want to provide channels for officers to come to us direct as well.
I'd say the same to the fire service.
In a similar way, so the majority of our work nowadays is my small team and I travel around Scotland and interview individuals in small groups of staff. Every time we're on a fire station, as an example, every time we're on a fire station, we insist that managers don't sit in the room with us. So we're just talking to a local crew or to individuals in that in that team. And each time we talk to people, we give them a guarantee of anonymity. So we explain how we'd manage things and how we'd deal with any comments they've got to make. And I mean, my experience is people are not nervous about that. In the same way that Mr. Penman said, they're forthcoming. I think firefighters and fire and rescue service staff are the same. They're quite happy when they're in a room with you to be very frank and open.
I want to thank you for being frank and open with us. And I'm bringing this evidence session to a close. Can I thank the committee for their questions? And we're now moving in, as we agreed earlier, into private session. Thank you.